Isn't it good to be in God's house today?
Amen.
So wonderful to see so many of you joining us today, and we're on our way to the book of Jonah. So turn to the Old Testament, to Jonah chapter 3. We're right in the middle of a four-part series on the book of Jonah, which is nice because it's in four chapters. We're stood a chapter every Sunday. And so far, we've watched Jonah run from God. God called him to do some things. He wanted him to go preach to the city of Nineveh. Preached to them that they needed to turn around from where they were and go toward God's direction instead. But he rebelled, he resisted, and he ran the opposite direction. So it says that God prepared a storm. Jonah ends up in the sea, and God prepared a big fish that swallowed him. Last week we saw Jonah's prayer in Jonah chapter 2. We saw his prayer from within the belly of the beast. It says that he was in there 3 days, and he began to realize that it was foolish to run from God. He began to realize that he had been really stupid. And I can relate to that feeling, can't you? When you look around in your life and you realize, man, I've made a bad mistake. I've gone the wrong direction. So he began to cry out, and he said, boy, I have gone to the depths. I have hit rock bottom. I have fallen so far, but I know that even in the belly of this great fish, I can cry out to God, and he'll hear my prayer. And it says, my prayer went into his holy temple, and he delivered me from the pit. He brought me up from the depths. He brought me to a higher place. He brought me up out of the bargain basement and set me on the mountaintop, he says. And no sooner had Jonah prayed that, if you look at Jonah 2:10, it says, the Lord spoke to the fish. I don't know if you've ever spoke to any fish before. I caught a few and spoke to them. But it says, the Lord spoke to the fish, and it vomited Jonah out onto the dry land. So imagine being Jonah and this fish eats you and you're thinking, that's it. I'm fish food. That's the end of my life. It's over. I'm done. I'm washed up. There's no hope. And then suddenly he cries out to God and a miracle happened. It doesn't say that that fish just got sick and vomited Jonah out. It doesn't say that he was punching and kicking so much in the belly of that whale that it spit him out on dry land. Now it says the Lord spoke to the fish. God showed Jonah mercy even after he ran, and it vomited him out onto the dry land. And I tell you, I would have liked to have been there and seen that. You wouldn't, but us preachers were weird. All right, Jonah chapter 3, we're going to read verses 1 through 10. Jonah comes out of the big fish, and he decides, I better do what God asked me to do. Amen? He said, I better get going the right direction because I've tried going the wrong direction. I tried going the way I wanted to go and doing what I thought was right and what I thought would be effective in my life. Look where it got me. And now that I'm out of that mess, I'm going to go the right direction. So he heads to Nineveh, right? And I've done the calculation that anywhere on the Mediterranean Sea that fish vomited Jonah up, he still had something like a 500-mile journey to go to Nineveh. So we're talking about an epic trek here, right? It says in Jonah 3:1 now, and to me, folks, this is one of the most beautiful verses in the entire Bible. Then the word of the Lord came to Jonah the second time, saying, arise, go to Nineveh, that great city, and call out against it the message that I tell you. So Jonah arose. He did as God commanded. And look what happened. He went to Nineveh, according to the word of the Lord, and tells us that Nineveh was an exceeding great city. It was 3 days' journey in breadth. You know, you could walk around in that city 3 days and probably not see all. It was that big. Jonah began to go into the city, going a day's journey. So he took off, he walked a day into that city, and he called out, yet 40 days, and Nineveh shall be overthrown. So he began to preach the doom that God had told him to preach on them. And look what happened in verse 5. The people of Nineveh believed God. They believed. They were message received, right? They called for a fast. They put on sackcloth from the greatest of them to the least of them. And it says the word reached the king of Nineveh, and he arose from his throne. He removed his robe, and he covered himself with sackcloth. And he sat in ashes, and he issued a proclamation and published throughout Nineveh by the decree of the king and his nobles, let neither man nor beast, herd nor flock, taste anything. We're all going to fast. them not feed or drink water, but let man and beast be covered with sackcloth, and let them call out mightily to God. Let everyone turn from his evil way and from the violence that is in his hands. And who knows? God may turn and relent and turn from his fierce anger so that we may not perish. So they got the message, and the king said, all right, let's call out to this God and tell him we're sorry. And who knows, maybe he won't wipe us off the planet like he said he was going to do. And look what happened. This is the God we serve. Verse 10 says, When God saw what they did, how they turned from their evil way, God relented of the disaster that he said he would do to them, and he did not do it. Let's have a word of prayer right here. Would you join me? Father, we come to you in the sweet name of Jesus today, Lord, just admitting our spiritual poverty, just admitting, Father, that we have nothing were it not for you. We're just like Jonah. Father, I want to pray this morning that you would invest in us the power of your word by the might of your spirit. I pray that we can hear it like the Ninevites heard it, and our hearts might turn today, Lord. I pray that you would show us new things, Father. I pray that you would show us exactly what we need to see in your word. I pray that every heart in this house could be open from youngest to oldest, just like in Nineveh, to receive the message of your truth. We just want to turn this service over to you, Lord, and put ourselves in your mighty hand, pray that you alone would guide us. And we pray it in Jesus' mighty name. Amen. I am thankful for second chances. Aren't you? I am thankful for second chances, not only with God. I mean, we see from this story, beyond a doubt, that we serve the God of second chances. We really do. But I'm thankful for second chances in life as well, you know, with natural things. And I'll tell you, I feel like I'm the king of needing another chance. I feel like that if there's anybody who understands second chances, it's your pastor. And Carrie loves to tell this story, so I'm going to tell it so you don't hear it from her, okay? When we first met, I thought she was interesting and gorgeous, spiritual, funny, but only a friend. You know, I didn't see her yet as someone I might date, let alone marry and be with nearly 21 years later. We went to a lot of the same Bible studies and prayer meetings together, and I would see her there, and we had a good time, but it just hadn't clicked in me because I'm dumb. It hadn't clicked in me to ask her out, you know? So there we were, just kind of going along as friends. I figured we were just buddies, you know? And one night, a friend of mine called me up and asked me if I could fix him up with Carrie for a date. He said, hey, you're pretty good friends with Carrie, right? I said, yeah. He said, see if she'd go out with me. I said, okay, sure. So I called up Carrie, and I asked her to go out with my friend. And she said yes, and I hung up the phone and immediately regretted it. All of a sudden, I felt a burning in my ears. You know that feeling, right? When something's wrong and you just can't figure out what it was. And it was at that precise moment I realized I had feelings for her. And it took the knowledge that she was going to go out with another guy to awaken that within me. But the second I fixed them up, I realized I was burning with jealousy. And I selfishly prayed to God that their date would be a disaster. I got on my knees and I said, God, I pray that their date is awful. I pray she finds this man repulsive. Some of y'all aren't laughing. Yeah. And I told God, I said, I will snap her up immediately if I get a second chance. Because I knew I had messed up asking her to go out with this friend of mine. I felt like a fool. You know, I'd been blind to how I really felt. And now I thought I would miss my chance to ask her out. I mean, what if they go on a date? It's a success. He marries her, you know. I will have missed my opportunity. And so I prayed for that second chance. And it turned out, Vanya, their date was a flop. I'm not telling you God answered my prayer and sabotaged the date, but I'm telling you it didn't go well anyway. Right, so it came out according to how I wanted it anyway, and I thought, all right, here's a second chance. You know, it turned out their date was a flop, and the rest is history. You know, second chance at romance turned out to be for a lifetime. And she loves to tell people this story. She'll meet you and she'll say, ever tell you about the time I met my husband and he asked me to go out with another guy? But that's what made me understand how I felt inside, was getting a second chance. So I've had some pretty big second chances in life that ended up being wonderful, that ended up being right. And Jonah here got a second chance. God gave him a second chance. Look at verse 1. I told you as I was reading it that this is one of the most beautiful verses in the Bible to me. And I'll tell you why in case you missed it, in case you didn't see it. It says, then the word of the Lord came to Jonah the second time. Now, if I was God, I probably would have given up on Jonah when he resisted me the first time. Now, you think about it. God calls the man and says, Jonah, I want you to go to Nineveh and preach to those people. And God's planning something big, right? And Jonah rebels. I feel like if I had been the Lord right there, I feel like I would have found somebody else who was willing if he wouldn't do it, right? I figure, well, there's bound to be some other prophet out there. There's bound to be somebody else who would go over there and preach. Jonah doesn't want to do it? Let him rot in that fish. I'm done with it. And that's why I'm not God, amen? Because I would have reacted with vengeance, right? But God wanted to show mercy and love to Jonah. Even though Jonah didn't care one iota about it, God wanted to show his grace to Jonah. And guess what? Here we sit in Centralia, thousands of years later, and God is still showing that mercy to us through Jonah's story. Now you think about the power of God's love. That's it right there. That he can show his love, his second chance giving love, to a man who couldn't stand to go on mission with him and rebelled against him thousands of years ago. And here we sit, still being blessed from the story. God's pretty big, amen? God can do some amazing things. And I tell you, it's powerful. It's powerful to behold, not just in Jonah's life, but it's powerful to behold in any life that is here today. Do you need, let me ask you a serious question. Do you need a second chance with God about something? Maybe he's been calling you in some way, and like Jonah, you resisted. It happens. I'll tell you about a time I did that here at the end of the sermon. But if you need a second chance, maybe you made a commitment to God once upon a time. You ever make a big promise to God and say, oh, Lord, if you'll do this, you'll do that. If you'll make their day a disaster, I'll do anything you wish for the rest of my life. Y'all can laugh, okay? Everybody's looking at me so seriously, like I'm saying something wrong. I probably am. If you made a commitment to God and then backed out, I've done it. You have too, more or less. I promise you. Maybe you made a commitment to God and ran away, like Jonah. Let me tell you a secret. Let me tell you something, church, this morning that I want you to understand. We have all been in Jonah's shoes together. There is not a person within the sound of my voice this morning that can claim and say, I have always served God. I've always done right. I have always kept my promises to the Lord. None of us in this room can say that. Because we're all in the flesh. We're all weak to sin. We all stumble. We all fall. And folks, there's a comfort in knowing that we're all in this together. Right? I mean, I'm not sitting up here at the front saying, well, I'm going to judge you this morning because you us preachers, we got no way. You know, maybe I'm just the sinner up here who happens to have a big enough mouth to preach. But I promise you, there's no difference in my soul and yours. We've all made promises to God we did not keep. We've all ran from God at times. We've all failed. We've all sinned. We've all fell down. And guess what? God loves all of us sinners just the same as he loved Jonah on that day. Every last one of you. And just the time you start thinking, well, I'm unlovely and I'm unworthy and God can't do anything with me, surely he's gave up on me. Folks, why would you think God would give up on you if he didn't give up on Jonah? Wouldn't you have given up on Jonah? Boy, nothing like 3 days in a fish's stomach, right? To turn your thinking around. Nothing like being vomited onto dry land to change someone's attitude, huh? Jonah figured out what was important. You know, the Lord here, it says that he told Jonah in verse 2, arise and go. Arise and go. And that reminds me of our study. Those of you who were here back in January, seems like a lifetime ago, but you remember we studied through Nehemiah together. And the big cry in Nehemiah is arise and build. Well, here's another arise and do something command from God. Not only does he want us to arise and build, he says arise and go. God is just waiting on some of you to get up and arise and say, I'm going to get on another level. I'm going to get out of the belly of the whale and I'm going to rise up. God wants to bring us all up a notch. Now, let me clarify something to you. You listening? God loves you exactly as you are. But he refuses to leave you that way. Are you hearing me and understanding with your spiritual ear this morning? That God loves you no matter who you are, what you're into, what you're up to, what you're feeling guilty about, how you've fallen, how you've ran. God loves you. But there comes a time when God is ready for you to arise and get going. There comes a time not to wallow around in the same sins anymore, church. I'm not telling you you have to earn the love of God. We've already seen God loves the most wretched, unlovable person. If he can love Jonah, he can certainly love you. But he refuses to leave you laying on that shore in whale puke. Can you say puke when you preach? Will you allow it? He's laying on the shore just in filth. You know, imagine how that must have smelled. You know, I mean, he's been in that fish 3 days. You ever catch any fish? They don't smell too good, right? Imagine having been on the inside of one. I mean, Jonah was a mess. And God said, arise. Arise and go. Get up. Come up a notch. Come up another level. No matter what your level of faith and excitement toward God has been, he wants you today to rise. There is no need to stay down in the depths. He's given a second chance to somebody today. And it's you. It's you. Because God is the God of second chances. You know, James chapter 4 tells us, you can read this later in your studies, James chapter 4 tells us, humble yourselves in the sight of the Lord, and he will lift you up. Sometimes you got to lay there in whale puke to get the point. Sometimes you got to wallow and lay in that nasty condition for a while before you finally decide, you know what? I want God to lift me out of this. I'm ready to rise up to a little higher level of living on the spiritual chart of things. I've been down here at square one for too long. It's time I advanced as a Christian. It's time I took some new steps. It's time I got to walking toward Nineveh like God wants me to. He doesn't want us to lay there on the beach. Amen, church? Amen. And some of us have been doing it for far too long. It's time to arise and go. Humble yourselves in the sight of the Lord. He will lift you up. And never was that more evident than here in the story of Jonah. And isn't that magnificent? The truth that you're hearing today. Think about the importance of it for a second. When you're at your lowest, and I'll tell you, how low can you go? Probably not as low as I've been. I know my sins. I know what I've done in the past. Isn't it magnificent that when you're at your lowest, your stinkiest, when you're at the most worthless state in your life, in your own estimation, God is there to lift and restore in his love. Even if you've run the other direction. Somebody here today is thinking, even me? Yes, even you. Even you. Some of you have a hard time forgiving yourselves from your past. How do I know? Because I kick myself daily for the things I've done in the past. I regret them. But God doesn't want you to wallow around in the whale vomit. You're doing that to yourself. He wants you to arise and go. Don't put back on the chains that Jesus has took off you. Don't be saddled up with more weight that God is trying to remove from you out of a sense of guilt. Because you're not doing God any favors by saying, "Oh, surely God, surely you don't love me that much. Surely you haven't forgiven me. Let me put some of the chains back on. Let me get some of that weight back on me because I deserve it. I deserve to drag this weight around for a while." God, let me tell you what. The scripture tells us that when God forgives, he forgets. Which I tell you, sounds like nonsense to the human ear. Because you and I, somebody does us wrong, we'll forgive them, but we'll never forget it. Amen. Boy, we hold on to a grudge. And so God says, "Well, wait a minute. I'm powerful enough, and I'm just enough, and I'm merciful enough to forgive and to forget." And that ought to blow our mind because his ways are higher than ours. Scripture tells us that as far as the east is from the west, that's how far God has removed our sin from us if we're forgiven in Jesus. Praise the Lord, O my soul, for that. Because I know the blackness of my own sins. I know what I've done. I know what I've committed. But I'm tired of wallowing around in it. Some of you need to forgive yourselves. Some of you need to turn yourself loose. Because God already did it a long time ago. You're dragging around those chains like Jacob Marley, you know, or a Christmas story. You got these chains on. No, God doesn't want that. When you're at your lowest, God will lift you. Now, as I said earlier, anywhere that whale puked out Jonah, anywhere that vomited him, he would have had at least a 500-mile journey to get to Nineveh. Okay? I bet that during that walk or wagon ride or however he got there, horseback, camelback, I don't know. However he arrived at Nineveh, whatever it was, Jonah had weeks to think about it. Weeks to think about what God had done for him. And guess what? Jonah was now an expert in second chances. Right? God will use the stuff you've been through to help somebody else. And Jonah, during this trip, during these weeks, out there, you know, rolling through the desert, heading toward Nineveh, he had time to think about what God had done for him, and he was now an expert on second chances. Having received some second chances, he knew that God was a giver of second chances, and guess what? You know what happened? He went and told those Ninevites that they needed to repent, that it was time to turn around and change. He went to them and he said it. And you read the scripture a while ago. You know what happened. God went and preached to those Ninevites and said, "Hey, you guys, you're a violent people." I mean, these Ninevites, they were barbarians. They were known for being some of the most warlike, mean people on the face of the planet. Jonah hated them. He didn't want to preach to them. That's why he ran. And God loved them, right? And he went to them and he said, "Hey, Ninevites, guess what? You're in a bad way, but God gives second chances. I'm living proof. A whale ate me, and here I am alive." Imagine what that must have sounded like. I'm going to preach on that tonight. You need to come back. But the message was heard, and it was effective, and the entire city began to change their hearts. And it says they put on sackcloth and ashes. And that's an Old Testament way of showing humility and desperation before God. It would be the equivalent of going out and getting a potato sack and wearing it. You know, and it's a way of showing humility and like, you know, I'm low, I'm going to abase myself before God. I'm going to throw ashes on myself. I'm going to absolutely make myself lower than dirt. It's a sign of deeply moved hearts. And I've spent some time, not in literal sackcloth and ashes, but in my heart, I've worn that sackcloth many a time before God. Times when I knew God wanted me to repent. Times when I knew God wanted me to change. And look at verse 8. It says, "Let man and beast be covered with sackcloth, even the cattle." They went out there and somehow or another they dressed the animals, the livestock, in sackcloth and ashes. That's how moved they were. They went all out. All out. They went sold out, fully invested in repentance. They had a citywide fast. Nobody ate. Everybody went hungry before God and crying out to the Lord. And guess what they did, church? Let me get your attention for a second. They accepted that they had done wrong and that God was angry with them. A lot of people today do not want to accept the fact that they have sinned. A lot of people today don't want to hear that there's a place called hell. That's getting less and less popular to preach. Somebody stand up here and tell you that hell is real, but it is. Read your Bible. People don't want to hear that, though. People want to hear, if it feels good, do it. You're all right. You're a pretty good old boy. Maybe you'll make it into heaven. People don't want to hear that they're wrong and they need to repent. But the Ninevites did. They said, we messed up. We have messed up. And so they went all out with their repentance. They said, let's show God we're sorry. And maybe he will change his mind. Because Jonah went and cried out. He said, 40 days is all you guys have. And God will overthrow this city. And do you know what it looks like when God overthrows a city? You read the Old Testament? Read your Bibles? You remember Sodom and Gomorrah? The place of total immorality and evil? God wiped those cities off the map with fire from heaven, and only Lot and his family survived. Just a handful of righteous people escaped that. And did you know that today, the site where they believe Sodom and Gomorrah was, nothing grows there to this day. It is barren rock. When God decides, I'm done, it's over, when the wrath of God hits, there is not a trace of that civilization left. You can't even find some of those civilizations from the Old Testament that God came against. And so the Ninevites, maybe they had heard of some of that, right? Maybe they had heard, hey, this is the God who does not play around. Let's repent. Let's change. And maybe it sounds weird for me to preach the love of God and the wrath of God at the same time. But I'm taking the Bible as a complete picture here, like you need to do. God loves you. He does. But the Ninevites knew that their days were numbered. And folks, they changed. How hard is it to change somebody's mind? How hard is it to change someone's mind? Have you ever heard the expression, you can lead a horse to water, but you can't make it drink? That expression exists because it's nearly impossible to change people's minds. And that's my job up here, right? You should believe your preacher's job is hard, right? Because I'm trying to change your mind today. And you know how hard it is to change minds. Let me ask you this. If it's hard to change someone else's mind, how hard is it to change your own mind? When is the last time you had a real change, a revolution in your thinking and in your heart? It probably took a lot to do it, right? And they say, hey, I'm not picking on you older folks, but they say, okay, I'm picking on you. They say the older you get, the more stuck you get, and the harder it is to change your mind. Something about being young, you're still malleable, you know, you're still shapeable, moldable in your theories, your suppositions about life, but the older we get, the harder it is to change. Am I stuck in my ways? Yes. You probably are too. You get in your rut, you decide things are right. But imagine being these Ninevites and finding out we've been wrong. Let me ask you a question. If you're wrong, would you rather know it or be ignorant to it? If you're wrong, do you have the guts to listen as someone tells you that you are wrong? These Ninevites, they heard that and they accepted it. And let me tell you what, church, Still listening? Thank you for your kind attention. Guess what? The man who had been given a second chance went to Nineveh and preached second chances. And the people cried out for a second chance. And you know what happened? God was so moved by their behavior, by the change of their heart, God was so moved, He gave them a second chance. This is an amazing story of redemption, but I tell you, it's just our story when you think about it, right? Some of us are so hard-headed, God deals with us for years on something before it finally breaks through. We say, well, I was wrong that whole time. How did I not know? Well, we're stuck in a rut, right? But I'm here to tell you, as a man who has received second chances from God, this morning, I am here at Cornerstone to preach to you second chances. And if you will ask God for a second chance, God will be so moved, He will give you a second chance. What happened with Jonah in Nineveh? Calm down, preacher. What happened to Jonah will happen to you. I know because I've been there. Can I tell you about another second chance? Another story. I told you about my second chance I got with my now wife. Let me tell you about another second chance I got. Many of you know my testimony and how when I was a teenager, I did some pretty rotten, evil stuff. I was addicted to all kinds of things and just a pretty rotten guy. And there came a point in my life where I hit rock bottom like Jonah did. And I cried out to God, and I felt that God was ready to give me a second chance. And that was on a Saturday night. God touched my life. And the next morning, I was in church. Found a friend of mine whose dad was a preacher, and I said, man, I need God to go to church with you. So I went. And I felt God's hand on my heart during that service. Like a brick sitting, not on my chest, but in my chest. I felt a weight. I knew that God was dealing with me. And the preacher, he got up and he preached, and it was great. I knew I was lost. I knew I was in sin. I knew my destination was hell. I knew that I needed to turn to Christ. And I felt, when the preacher got up at the end and started giving an altar call and saying, come today if you want to be saved. If you want to be forgiven, you need to come up here today and pray with me. I felt the Holy Spirit urging me to answer that call. I was on the back row. And I was gripping that pew, right, and weighing it out. I knew God was calling me, but I knew people would make fun of me and find me ridiculous if I suddenly transformed my life to being a Christian. I knew that I didn't want to do it halfway. I had all these questions about it, and I sat there and I felt God saying, come to me. Come to me, and I will give you rest. I will give you forgiveness. I felt God telling me that, and they ended the song. And they prayed a final prayer, and they closed church, and it ended, and I had denied God. Because I was scared. Just out of being a chicken, I denied God. But I told God, I made a deal with God, like you do sometimes, and I told Him if He would give me another chance and would touch me like that again, that I would respond. I begged Him. I begged Him. I said, God, please do not give up on me. I don't understand it all, and I'm worried what people will think, and I don't know what's even going on, but I know You're real, and if You give me another chance, I'll go. I'll do it. Guess what? That night, I went back to Sunday night church. And I felt Him call me the same way. God gave me a second chance. And I remember the preacher calling and saying, come to the front if you want to receive Christ. And I remember stepping out of my pew and somehow getting to the altar, but I don't even think I moved my legs. I think God just picked me up and carried me after I made that one step. Like wings were on my feet. I stepped out of that pew and went to the altar. And I gave my life to Jesus.
And I couldn't have known at that time where God was going to take me or what he was doing. That's why this Christian life is an adventure. Had you told me that day, hey, guess what? 24 years from now, you're going to be preaching. I would have said, you're nuts. There's no way. God only wanted me to go the first step. And he gave me a second chance. And were I to tell you all the times that God has given me a second chance since then, we'd be here a month. It would take me a month to tell you all the times that I get a second chance from God, because, folks, it's daily. Every time I fall, every time I sin, every time I disappoint myself and my family and God, every time I feel like laying there in the well vomit and giving up, God gives me a second chance and picks me back up. We all fall. We all fail. We all rebel. We all strike out. But God refuses to leave us there in the depths. And that's the message of the story of Jonah. No matter how deep you go, no matter how far you run from God, no matter how much you want to give up, he's still there. And I'm like David in the Psalms. I say, where can I hide from your presence, God? Could I go across the sea? You're there. Could I go to the highest mountain? You're still there. If I go to the depths of the earth, even there your spirit will find me. Folks, it's time for you to do something with the call that God has placed on your life. It's time for all of us to arise and go. And it's time to let go of past mistakes, to turn fully to God once again, and to arise. Get a hymnal, please, and turn to hymn number 550. 550. I want to thank you for listening so well this morning, especially to a guy who's in a chair. Some of you have a hard time even seeing me. That's about all.